You're listening to the Chad Easty Show on demand. Good for you. Now download the KFYO app and listen live weekday afternoons, 5 to 7 p.m. Central.
Broadcasting from the great state of Texas, this is the Chad Easty Show. News and views with a Lone Star perspective. You can sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Or call in at 1-800-687-0790. Now, here's Chad Easty.
Good evening, Lubbock, Amarillo, Wichita Falls, Abilene, Dallas, Fort Worth, down in Houston, over in El Paso, and anywhere else, inside or outside the great state of Texas, wherever you may be listening on this Thursday evening, January 4th, 2024. Oh, yeah, the week is almost over. The first week of the new year, almost over. We're getting closer to the week wrapping up, and we've got some weather outside. The weather here, we've got some rain that's falling in Lubbock and in parts of Lubbock, and kind of a right around the loop or so, and inside the loop. We're drying off now, it appears, just a little bit south of Lubbock and then into into some of our southern areas and southern Lubbock County, and then into, we've got rain in Wilson and moving into Slayton. We've got some rain, but in the city of Lubbock, it's we're just cold right now. We've had rain all day long. Then you go north of Lubbock into Plainview, in between Newdale and Plainview, right a little bit east of I-27 and into Plainview. Heavy rain, and then once you go north into, north of Crest, all the way up to Amarillo, and a little bit, north west of Amarillo, snow falling in our northern listening areas. So we've got rain, we've got snow, we've got fog, and we've got cold temperatures. And if you are in the Wichita Falls area, you don't have any of that right now, at least not weather-wise. You don't have any weather falling on you, but it's moving that way. Same for Abilene. It's all moving in your direction. Congratulations. You'll get some of the wet stuff before maybe the end of the day. So if you're traveling and listening to us, driving anywhere in West Texas, driving along I-20 towards Abilene, by the end of the show today, looks like rain will start falling in Abilene and possibly Wichita Falls as well. So over the next 2 hours, if you're listening to us driving around, you may get some wet stuff while you're out driving around. Be careful, especially in the northern areas where snow is falling. And if you've got any weather photos, you can always submit those on the text line. We do get photos on the text line from time to time, especially when people are really excited about the weather or crazy traffic that they're seeing. They like to send those in. How do you get in touch with us? It's real simple. The text line is always fired up at 806-680-2790. You can always give us a call at 1-800-687-0790. That's 1-800-687-0790. When you do text in, let us know who you are, where you're listening from, and any comments that you have. Some, you know, a lot of people like to use the text line. They like to fire off a quick comment or two. But if you want to get into a debate, or if you want to get into a back and forth, a Q&A, or you have a few things to say about a subject, give us a call at 1-800-687-0790. The producer and show librarian, Nick, the first voice you hear from when you dial in today, we have upgraded his title to show librarian. He's in charge of the Dewey Decimal System, whatever that is these days. Do kids even learn about the Dewey Decimal System? Do they learn about that at all? Do they know the Dewey Decimal System when they go to the library? Probably not. So we've got all that to talk about on the show. John and Abilene saying that they've had misty fog all day. We've had that too. We've had the misty fog. We've had the dense fog. We've had the freezing fog. And then we've had the rain. It's been one of those days. It's been one of those. I think a lot of people like this type of weather because if they like to relax with a good book, you know, they like to relax with a good book and maybe sit around and enjoy the day if they don't have to go into work or if they go, I can't make it in today. Can't make it in. The sickness has gotten a hold of me. Whatever the sickness is out there, they like to curl up with a good book. One of the questions we do ask you today, your running topic, and I've seen this posted from a lot of people, so I'm kind of ripping this off from just the world of social media. Give me a couple of good books that people need to read in 2024. It's kind of one of those, again, it's a book day. It's kind of one of those days where you want to, if you do curl up with a good book or break out that e-reader, you know, for the young kids out there, books used to involve paper. Now you just read them on your tablet. But back in the day, they came in many different forms, but it involved paper that you would flip pages. I know it's old. I know. But some books were leather bound. Those were very nice books. Now they all come on a tablet and you just hit the button and you go to the next page. But for those of you who like to read books, what are some recommendations going into, well, we are into the new year, but going into the first big weekend of the new year, what are some books that people need to read? Give me a couple of ideas. You can send them in. They can be fiction, nonfiction. Just some good books that people need to read in 2024. You can text in 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Nick, the first voice you hear from when you dial in, and we called him the librarian earlier. Nick, I want to bring you in here. When I saw you today, I said, new sweater? You said yes. And you were, I guess, trying to decide what look you were going for.
Yeah, obviously, I always dress with purpose.
Right.
I'll preface my response with that. So every day I wake up, and I know it's going to be a sweater, but I always ask myself, what am I going for? What do I want people to perceive me as I'm wearing this sweater that I picked? So today, I gave you three options.
Yeah.
I gave you, well, let me explain the look.
Please do. Yes, please
so
do.
So I have this tan... looks like a quilted blanket, a knitted blanket.
Yeah. Is it tan? I like to call it West Texas white.
Okay. Stand out in the, you know, dust storm a little bit.
Exactly. It's a West Texas white.
Exactly. It's bright. It's a bright. We'll just call it off-white.
It's not bright.
It's off.
No, it's
debatable.
Not, it's not bright.
Anyway, I buttoned it up this time. Usually,
okay. Yeah.
Now, this is a cardigan.
Yes.
Usually, I don't button these up.
Right.
I just...
You're rocking the Mr. Rogers look
exactly,
today.
Exactly. Yeah. So I buttoned it up today. I think I look a little too proper.
Okay.
I'll admit it.
Definitely for radio, yes.
Exactly, yeah.
Yes.
So I'm stepping... It's 2024. It's
right.
A new year.
Yeah.
I'm buttoning up my sweaters now. I'm being a little wild.
Yeah.
but so when I walked out of the house, I looked in the mirror before I left, and I'm like, this is very either librarian-esque, grandfather... Or what was the third one that I said? I gave you three, and I forgot which.
Preppy boy.
Was that what I said?
Preppy? He said something like preppy boy.
Preppy schoolboy or something.
Yeah, preppy schoolboy, which kind of, it was kind of weird, but okay. I mean, well, we can
That's
go for it. Sure.
It's an option, yeah. It's C. Yeah. No, nobody picks C anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
But anyway, so I'm like, it boils down to librarian or grandfather is what I what I went for. So I think we agreed librarian is probably... or like a preschool teacher. I look like I just got done teaching a very boring history class to some 4-year-olds.
See, for that though, I would think you need some glasses to pull that off.
Yeah, I walk around with a book in my hand.
You definitely need the book. Yeah.
That ties into yours.
Yeah, well, that's there true. That's true. You if you had some books, and maybe like a. Some oval glasses, you know what I'm talking about? Some oval glasses.
And my hair, I have to brush like strands of hair out.
Yeah,
of, like, my,
then
my glasses.
You would be like NPR guy.
Right.
And of course, that's boring.
Yeah, no one
so you don't want to be that guy.
No.
No, you don't want to, Hello, everyone. Welcome
yeah.
to Nick's discussion on sweaters.
Right, right.
And the history of sweaters.
Right. It has to be history, yeah.
You're listening to a very important edition
yeah.
of the Chad Hastie Show featuring Nick talking about the history of sweaters.
You're actually spoiling. Pretty soon we're going to unveil that for the next hour. So.
Yeah, actually, yeah, that's...
We're cutting your show in half, by
yeah,
the way.
Yeah, for people who don't know, that's the next best of, is actually just Nick.
It's live.
As NPR Nick.
Right,
And speaking to you about the history of sweaters.
Right.
So get ready for that next month.
I don't know how this started, but librarian.
Yeah.
Long story short, TLDR. Librarian, because I buttoned up my
yeah.
cardigan.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I like it. It's a little preppy.
It's a good look. Yeah. It's a fine look out there. It's dapper. You're going dapper on us, and that's fine. You can text in your favorite book at 806-680-2790. There's a big piece out of Texas Monthly. The headline, Texas GOP Civil War is messier than anyone expected. Oh, about once or twice a year, you start seeing the news stories coming out about the GOP civil war within the Texas Republicans, and it's always a fun story to read through and understand that Republicans are mad at each other within the Republican Party. Which, by the way, it's primary season, so of course this is the time of year where Republicans are going to disagree with each other. There's disagreement also within the Democrat Party, and I want people to know that. Before we get into this whole story, and we'll take a break first before we do that, but before we get into this whole story from Texas Monthly, there's also a lot of infighting within the Democrat Party, but here's the problem. The Democrats aren't in power. They have no power in Texas. They have no... they have really no future right now to speak of in Texas. They don't have any type of surge in Texas, so it's not sexy to write about. The disagreements that you see within the Democrat Party, they disagree with each other, but it's not fun to talk about because they're not in power. And so the heads of the Democrat Party, well, nobody really cares about them very much. On the Republican side, there's a lot of disagreement, and there's some sexiness to it when you get into the fights and the different endorsements that's going on. So we'll get into all of that here when we come back. You're on the Chad Hastie Show. The Civil War within the Texas Republican Party, is it kind of the same Civil War that's going out throughout the entire Republican Party? We'll be right back.
Eddie waited till he finished high school.
The Chad Hastie Show can be heard all over West Texas, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Tune in on News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO in Lubbock, News Talk 940 in Amarillo, News Talk 94.7 and 1470 KYYW in Abilene, and in Wichita Falls on News Talk 96.3 and 1290. The Chad Hastie Show. Make it a part of your drive home, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Speeding tickets aren't cheap, and they can make your insurance rates go up too. So if you don't remember anything else from this commercial, remember this. Slow down or pay up. Also, if law enforcement pulls you over for speeding, they'll check your license and registration. So be ready for that. Basically, if you ever wonder if speeding is worth it, the answer is pretty obvious. No way. Speeding is dangerous and expensive. So slow down or pay up. Be safe, drive smart. A message from TxDOT.
On Sunday nights, Ben Ferguson. Sunday evenings from 6 to 9 on News Talk KFYO.
All right, welcome back to the Chad Hastie Show. Story out of the Texas Monthly. They have three authors on this piece from Texas Monthly. And they start off, what does it mean to be a Texas Republican? This year saw the state GOP tear itself apart over that question. Really? Did it? The impeachment and subsequent acquittal of Attorney General Ken Paxton and a protracted fight over school vouchers, a program that would let parents use taxpayer dollars to subsidize their children's private education. See, nowhere in there. They don't say that it would actually send lower income students to better schools or private schools, and it would help parents pay for that school. They don't want to put that in there. No, no, no. Instead, it's they want to subsidize children's private education. Anyway, I don't have time to get off on that one. The GOP broke itself into warring factions, the pro and anti-Paxton, the pro and anti-voucher, all claiming to represent true conservative. The pro-Paxton wing accuses its rivals of being Republicans in name only, rhinos. Conventional wisdom holds civil wars roughly divided between the far-right wing of the Texas GOP and the center-right wing. But a close examination shows that to be too simplistic. Texas Monthly analyzed relative economic and social conservatism of all 104 Republicans in the legislature alongside each member's vote on impeachment to determine a lawmaker's social conservatism. We use this ratings compiled by the Texas Values Action, a group that opposes abortion rights and gay marriage. For economic conservatism, we use ratings published by Texans for Fiscal Responsibility, which champions limited government spending. They wrote, we found GOP civil war does not break along clean ideological lines. Whether a Republican was relatively centrist or very right-wing didn't accurately predict to their impeachment vote. This is not new, by the way. All you've had to do is go through and watch how all this played out. And we talked about this during the impeachment trial and afterwards, that there were Republicans who were not considered part of the, quote, far right-wing or most conservative that decided against impeachment. And then there were some who voted for impeachment. It was Republicans all over the place in the House who voted for and against impeachment. It has made for some strange bedfellows when it comes to that issue of the Paxton endorsement or the Paxton impeachment. And now the subsequent Paxton endorsement. There are people who Paxton is endorsing, and those who only care about one issue, and that issue being the impeachment trial of Ken Paxton, there are some out there who that is their singular issue that they are talking about right now. And they want you to think that everyone who voted to impeach Ken Paxton is a rhino. That's simply not true. It's just like the people who are mad at Chip Roy for endorsing Ron DeSantis over Donald Trump. And they want to label Chip Roy as a rhino, which Chip Roy is not a rhino. Chip Roy is one of the biggest conservative fighters we have. Rich Cocaine is not a rhino. You look at another side of this, which is the school choice fight. Guess what? Some of the most conservative voices in the Republican Party are for school choice, period. And you have an endorsement coming from the governor for those who embrace school choice. Some of those endorsements are opposite of who Ken Paxton is endorsing. This GOP civil war, which if you want to call it that, fine. It's been going on for a while. There have been battle lines for a while over who's going to control the party, but that's always happened. It's, like I said, it's happening within the Democrat Party as well. It's just not as sexy in the Democrat Party because the Democrats don't control a damn thing. The Republican Civil War, if you want to call it that, which I think at this point, that phrase doesn't even matter. Just like the phrase rhino doesn't matter anymore. If we're going to assign rhino as a term to everyone that we've just disagreed with once within the Republican Party, the rhino term doesn't mean anything, and it's jumped the shark. But during this time period, during the primary season, is when there's supposed to be a civil war. It's a primary. The biggest place where this is playing out, though, as far as the civil war goes, quote unquote, is on social media and among those who are endorsing people. For a lot of average voters, they're going to be confused as hell when they see some of these endorsements that come out. because they've heard for years and years, that some of these guys are uber conservative, far right wing, which is what they voted for. But now they're going to get a flyer in the mail that says, well, no, because they voted for the impeachment of Ken Paxton, they're a rhino. Well, what? For the average voter, that doesn't make any sense. Where this big battle is really being played out is on social media and among those who are endorsing candidates and those who want to have more influence within the party. And that's been going on for a long time. You're going to have battles within the Republican Party. I think it's healthy to have battles within the Republican Party. Now, I don't always agree with some of the methods. I don't always agree with some of the timing and some of the language that's used. I don't always agree that the infighting has to continue after the primary season. I think after the primary season, you all get together and you vote against the Democrats. But is the current civil war, quote unquote, any messier than what we've seen in the past? Probably not. Probably not any messier. It's just amplified because of social media. And I think more voters are confused over the disjointed endorsements that are out there. And that's something that'll probably continue. And why I don't think the endorsements matter that much. We'll be right back.
Call in to the Chad Hasty Show at 1-800-687-0790. The Chad Hasty Show, broadcasting on the Texas Town Square Media Network.
This message is from the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs. Veterans deserve to know about the best services available to them. VA's new radio outreach page is a prime source for that information. The page, news.va.gov/outreach/radio, houses public service announcements that educate veterans on a cross-section of topics. That's news.va.gov/outreach/radio.
There will be one less birthday party to celebrate today. One less coffee date with a friend today. One less family dinner today. Because there will be one less motorcycle rider on the road today. On average, a motorcyclist is killed on Texas roads every day. When you're behind the wheel, obey the speed limit and be extra careful at intersections. Let's start turning that one less into one more. Please share the road and look twice for motorcycles. There's a life riding on it. A message from TxDOT.
The news and talk of West Texas. News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO. You're listening to The Chad Hasty Show.
Welcome back to The Chad Hasty Show. You know, some things don't change. Even in a new year, some things don't change. Like we like to have on our great friends over at the Texan.news. McKenzie DiLullo back again with us on this Thursday. McKenzie, Happy New Year. How are you today?
I'm so well, Chad. Happy New Year to you.
How are things going over at the Texan?
We're good. We're ready for this year. Folks want to know what we're thinking are going to be the top stories. We have a story about the Texan of, like, our top six things to watch in 2024. We're all full of great Christmas food, back at it, back in the groove of things, and trying to make sure we cover everything for everybody.
That's right. And for those who maybe you haven't checked out the Texan.news, but you need to, we got stories from all over the state of Texas, obviously following the state legislature in depth, and also just news around the state, including one of the big stories out today is about citizens in Amarillo taking up this abortion ordinance.
Certainly something we've been trying to watch here for months now. A group of citizens in Amarillo has now decided to begin the citizen initiative process to advance an ordinance we've seen passed throughout the state that would provide greater protections for the unborn within the city limits. Jana May is a member of the Sanctuary for the Unborn Ordinance initiating committee, quite a name, a resident of Amarillo. She's been working toward getting this ordinance passed since 2020. She's served as a leader in local Republican clubs. And essentially what the ordinance would do is prohibit abortion within the city limits of Amarillo, as well as abortion trafficking, which is defined as the transportation of persons to get an abortion on the roads through the city. The ordinance has a private enforcement mechanism that's very similar to the one in the state's Heartbeat Act. And we've seen this passed in 50 cities and several counties in Texas. The citizen initiative process requires about 6,000 signatures from registered Amarillo voters. Once those are collected and verified, a very important process, the ordinance will be presented to the city council, and they can either accept or reject the ordinance in the exact form proposed. If the ordinance is rejected, citizens can then be, the ordinance can then be placed on the ballot for the next available election, which could come as soon as May. So, certainly a new strategy here from folks in Amarillo. We'll keep an eye on it. May said to us, "I would be very proud to live in Amarillo, to say the city I live in is a sanctuary city for the unborn." So we'll keep an eye on this and watch what the city council does.
All right. And then another story dealing with one of our statewide elected officials and their home being swatted. What does that mean?
I didn't know until this week, Chad. So essentially, so we'll start with the definition. Swatting is making a hoax call to 911, a fake call, to draw a response from law enforcement, usually a SWAT team. So very serious crime and has potentially dangerous consequences. So setting up some sort of, say, hey, I'm barricaded in a house with something going on, with us, basically necessitating a SWAT team, and law enforcement is then, of course, required to respond to that. And this happened at Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton's home. The Attorney General announced it this last Wednesday morning that his home in McKinney was where this happened. The Attorney General took to social media to alert the public and said he and his family were not home at the time, but were made aware of the false report when a state trooper who was contacted by the McKinney police informed them of the incident. This is a quote from the Attorney General. On New Year's Day, a currently unidentified caller made a false report to 911 describing a life-threatening situation at our home in McKinney. As a result, the city of McKinney police and fire departments quickly and bravely responded to what they believed could be a dangerous environment. Now, of course, the Attorney General and the Speaker of the House, Dave Phelan, have been at odds for months now as the impeachment effort against the Attorney General started in the House here in Texas, in Austin. And Paxton took the opportunity and said it is also important to acknowledge that this swatting incident happened weeks after the disgraced Speaker of the House, Dave Phelan, doxed our family by publicly posting our address. Quick background on that. In October, Paxton filed criminal complaints regarding a document dump related to this impeachment trial that happened over the summer. A lot of those documents were unredacted and included some personal information, which was the home address of the Paxtons, Ken and his senator wife, Angela Paxton. But that was the address of their Austin home. The McKinney home address where the swatting incident occurred was not included. So notable there, Paxton said that he and his family have received multiple threats of violence following the document release and noted the legislature passed an anti-doxing law to stop the far left from using intimidation tactics. His quote, but yes, very notable that this law was passed. It creates a criminal offense in the case of a person who posts publicly accessible personal information with the intent to harm. So lots going on here. We've seen multiple swatting incidents happen over the Christmas break here with different Republican lawmakers and some Democrat lawmakers as well. So keep an eye on this. Certainly a crazy incident, and we're grateful no one was hurt.
Now, do we know if because this happened in McKinney. Was this home address known before the trial?
Known as relative. You certainly have options to look up folks and their addresses with local entities, tax offices and things like that. So it can be made publicly available, but notable in that this McKinney address was not part of the document dump that the Attorney General was speaking about in his tweet.
All right. And then another one of the big stories that y'all have up over at the Texan News. And there's actually a couple of stories dealing with this. Still with the busing and sending illegal immigrants out of town, out of Texas, and even Mayorkas getting involved and going after the governor on some of this.
Yes, we have kind of a dual hit here, Chad.
Yeah.
So we have congressional Republicans who've, you know, been continuing their effort to impeach Mayorkas, the U.S. Homeland Security Secretary, and Abbott went after the White House official this week after he included climate change as one of the reasons for the illegal immigration crisis on the southern border. This was in an interview on MSNBC where, when asked about December's all-time record of enforcement encounters along the southern border, which is about 302,000, Mayorkas said, you know, I'm involved in bilateral, multilateral meetings with my counterparts from foreign countries in Europe, Asia, the Indo-Pacific, all over the world. We have the effects of climate change, poverty, increasing level of authoritarianism, the very many challenges that are the root cause of the displacement of people around the world. Abbott responded, had a lot to say. He said, climate change? Mayorkas is pathetic. The real reason illegal immigration records are being set is because Biden refuses to enforce immigration laws. We will send more buses and planes. We will continue building the razor wire walls that Biden wants to tear down. That's from the governor. Now, you mentioned New York earlier. Mayor Eric Adams of New York City, where Texas has sent approximately 161 non-citizens, has called the policy of busing those illegal immigrants cruel and humane. And just today, it was announced that Mayor Adams announced a lawsuit against the bus companies that are, quote, complicit in Abbott's busing program. So we'll continue to keep an eye on that. Notable as well to mention that Homeland Security Committee Chairman Mike Green, a Republican from Tennessee, announced that the committee will hold its first official hearing focused on impeaching Mayorkas on the charges related to the border crisis on January 10th. So we will certainly keep an eye on that and keep an eye out for what's next.
All right. McKenzie, tell folks what else they can find over at the Texan.news today.
Absolutely. We have a lot of news happening with all the Epstein documents that are making their way into the public sphere. We have a story up on a couple of stops that his plane made in Texas. Certainly getting a lot of eyeballs on it right now. And like I said, we have a lot of New Year's look ahead pieces to go take a look at, 2023 wrap ups to look at, all at the Texan.news.
All right. As always, McKenzie, thank you for your time. And y'all keep up the great work over at the Texan News.
Thank you so much, Chad. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you as well. That's McKenzie DiLullo with the Texan.news. When we come back, we've got other news to get into, your phone calls, your text, your recommended books that people need to read in 2024. We'll get to those. And, oh, yeah, we've got tickets for the Gun and Blade show to give away, too. We'll be right back.
Battle is to fight, to struggle, to overcome, and ultimately for the Marine Corps, it means to win. There is no alternative. It's not just a statement of intent. It's a promise to our nation. A promise kept for more than two centuries. A promise of the Marines.
Diane from Michigan, a disabled senior citizen trying to get by. Henry from Florida, a veteran fighting to make ends meet. Elena from Arizona, a mother struggling to feed her daughter. Hi, I'm Connie Britton, and I support Feeding America because they help provide over 6 billion meals to people in need each year, like Diane, Henry, and Elena. Learn more at feedingamerica.org. Feeding America, 200 food banks strong.
Chad HD Show. Appreciate you being out there today. We ask you the running topic today. What book recommendations would you make to people in 2024? We were doing this because, well, basically today's been one of those days where if you're not working, it's one of those good, kind of a good day to curl up, read a book, get into a new book. A lot of people asking on social media book recommendations for 2024. So we ask you, the listening audience out there, what are your book recommendations for 2024? They can be fiction, nonfiction, whatever. You can send those in at 806-680-2790. Let's see. Some textures weighing in. Chronicle of Brothers by Wendy Alec. Texture also says that the button-up sweater look is very dapper. So that's good for Nick, the producer and show librarian. He likes the dapper look. Another texture, Robert in Oklahoma, saying, I suggest every young reader should read The Hungry Caterpillar to introduce them to the world of paper books. It's a world of paper books. You just got to turn the page and going all the way through. It's wonderful. So The Hungry Caterpillar. That from Robert in Oklahoma. Let's see another texter weighing in. Chad, good to hear you back on the air. Question, what do you think of or about Whistle Pig Whiskey, Mark in California? There's a lot of Whistle Pig rye whiskeys that are out there. They've got quite a few of the Whistle Pigs that are out there. I've had a few of them. I'm a fan. When I'm in the mood for a rye, Whistle Pig is a very good rye option that's out there. Now, depending on which Whistle Pig you look at and which Whistle Pig you're choosing, you can get into some very pricey territory. very pricey territory for what they put out. And I haven't had them all. I can tell you that. I've had a few of the Whistle Pigs, and they're pretty good. I haven't had one that I just don't like. But if you're looking for a rye whiskey, Whistle Pig's a good one. I used to be very into ryes. I've kind of gotten away from rye whiskeys for a little bit. This time of year, they're good. They have that nice little spice to them. Rye whiskeys do, so I kind of get back into them right around this time of year. But I've been more towards just the nice bourbon whiskeys, staying away from the ryes just recently. There's so many good bourbons out there, so many good ones out there. And something that if you're a fan of whiskey, and myself and a good buddy of mine, Matt Martin, we do a podcast each week called Current and Cask, where we review different whiskeys, and we'll have a new episode that'll drop this Saturday, the first one of the new year that'll drop this Saturday. Wes, I highly recommend Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Another texture weighing in. Bill from North Carolina, the Holy Bible, King James Version, is a great book. That certainly is, absolutely. Great read, My Life in the Cage, by Nick Two Toes Touching. You can get in on the text line at 806-680-2790. Let's see. You can send in your thoughts as well. Going back just real quick to this piece from Texas Monthly, we're not going to spend a lot more time going into the next hour on it. They do get into some of the different players, I guess you could say, in this Texas Monthly piece. And they have a big write-up on Dustin Burroughs in this. And they label Burroughs the conservative wonk who crossed Paxton. Burroughs, more than anyone else, exemplifies the battle lines of the Civil War drawn primarily over the Paxton impeachment vote. And again, that's not exactly true. It is from the pro-Paxton folks in the media that only focuses on Paxton. But when you look at other battle lines, such as school choice, well, those who are all for school choice and those who have been pushing for more regulation of the cities and those who have been pushing for smaller government, a lot of those folks are aligned in their endorsements of Dustin Burroughs. When you look at school choice, when you look at the Texas Values Coalition and some of these other groups, they're absolutely in line with Burroughs on this and have been endorsing Burroughs. You've seen Ken Paxton. I think Paxton's endorsed Burroughs' opponent. I know Sid Miller has. Sid Miller came out yesterday and endorsed Wade Cowan in that race. But even, you know, what was pointed out about that endorsement is that Sid Miller was endorsing some people who were going against those who were against school vouchers and school choice. So again, this is where you have the quote-unquote battle lines that are all mixed and matched, and why there are going to be a lot of voters out there who are going to be confused whenever they get these pamphlets out there who say that candidate XYZ is a rhino. And then the next pamphlet they get, it'll say, well, no, candidate X, Y, and Z, they're the rhino. You're going to have a lot of rhino finger pointing going on in some of these races. The story goes on here about Burroughs. During his 8 years in office, he's been an architect of right-wing policy. Love how they put that, right-wing policy. Evil right-wingers in the House on limiting property taxes, building border barriers. And he regrets more Texans don't recognize him as such. He sometimes bemoans that others in his party take credit for his achievements, such as passing bills overriding local regulations on businesses, and then receives adulation on TV while he is stuck in the wonk trenches. I don't know if I've ever heard anything described as the wonk trenches in the Texas legislature. That's a new one. And I don't know if he actually is in the wonk trenches. We'll be right back.
The Chad Hastie Show, a presentation of the Texas Town Square Media Network. The views and opinions expressed during the Chad Hastie Show are not necessarily the views of this station staff, management, advertisers, or Town Square Media. Broadcasting from the great state of Texas, this is the Chad Hastie Show. News and views with a Lone Star perspective. You can sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Or call in at 1-800-687-0790. Now, here's Chad Hastie.
Welcome back to the Chad Hastie Show, final hour of the program today. It's like take a quick look here at the radar. I know Amarillo's been getting some snow. So if you're heading north, get ready for some little snow action up in the panhandle. And they've got snow. Basically, if you're looking at a map right now, not too much if you're in the Plainview area, but north into the Panhandle, Canyon, Amarillo, Dumas, Dalhart, all getting the heavy snow right now. And then if you look in some other area, Pampa getting a little bit of snow rain as well. And if you kind of take a look around the radar, it's moving towards Wichita Falls. Definitely getting some rain I-20, getting some rain, and of course along Highway 82 all the way. You're getting some rain. So lots of showers out there. Let's see, a little rain. I know it's been misty and rainy in Abilene, getting some of that right now as well, especially north of Abilene into Haskell and all the way into the Panhandle, into the Panhandle and into Oklahoma as well, getting a little bit of that rain as the radar that we're looking at right now on the AccuWeather radar. All right, so be careful out there as you're driving around. Do appreciate you tuning in today. Just a reminder for those of you in Lubbock, we're going to be broadcasting from the Lubbock Memorial Civic Center on Saturday, 2 to 4 p.m. So come out, join us as we broadcast from the Gun and Blade Show this Saturday, 2 to 4 p.m. We'll see you there. If you do go out there and you swing by the table, we'll have a microphone set up to where you can kind of sound off on any of the topics that you would like to get into as we broadcast again from the Gun and Blade Show. In fact, if you'd like to go to the Gun and Blade Show, Nick, I think we've got some tickets left, don't we? We got about three. Let's say right now we'll do three family four packs of tickets to the Gun and Blade Show. You got to pick these tickets up by tomorrow. By tomorrow, you got to pick these tickets up at the radio station in Lubbock. So let's say the first three people in at 1-800-687-0790. You can also dial in locally at 806-699-5396, 806-699-5396, or 1-800-687-0790. We'll get you hooked up with a family four-pack of tickets for the Gun and Blade Show in Lubbock. So, be the first three people in, and we'll get you hooked up with some tickets there. 806-680-2790. That's the text line that you can sound off on and get in on any of the topics of the day. We've also been asking you, of course, to weigh in on the running topic, which is your favorite books. What book recommendations would you make going into 2024? What book should people read in this 2024 year? You can text in 806-680-2790. A story that's going to get swept away. Iowa school shooting leaves a sixth grader dead, five injured. The suspected shooter identified as a 17-year-old there in Iowa. Now, the story's going to get, it looks like it's going to get swept under the rug. The White House, they've already talked about how there's gun violence in America. They need to do something about it. But it looks like this is going to be one of those stories that gets swept under the rug because this shooter, at least some of the evidence that's come out, was in the LGBTQ world. At least five people were shot. One child died after a school shooting today in a small Iowa town. Police responded to reports of gunfire at Perry High School at 7:37 a.m. before classes had begun on what was the first day of school after winter break. When officers arrived at the scene less than 7 minutes later, they found multiple gunshot victims. The suspected shooter identified as Dylan Butler, 17, who was a student at the school. According to the assistant director of Iowa Division of Criminal Investigation, said in an afternoon press conference, Butler was found with a self-inflicted gunshot wound. Four of the surviving victims were taken to hospitals, one in critical but not life-threatening condition, four in stable condition. Four of the surviving victims are students. One is a school administrator, according to authorities. Authorities found a rudimentary improvised explosive device inside the school, which was rendered safe, they added. Butler had a pump-action shotgun and a small-caliber handgun on him. He also made social media posts around the time of the shooting. Perry, a town of about 8,000 people, the high school, part of the 1,785-student Perry Community School District. That according to Fox News. Now, some of the other news that had come out about the shooter, and it was from his social media post, is that he was, quote-unquote, gender fluid, and that he was part of the LGBT community. Now, we've seen in other cases where you have people who have been these shooters before, who have been part of the LGBT community, have been gender fluid, and have lashed out at other students and administrators. And these shootings get swept under the rug. You know, it doesn't fit the narrative. It doesn't fit the narrative that the administration wants to talk about. It doesn't fit the narrative that, if you allow someone to transition or you allow someone to be gender fluid, they're going to be A-okay, that they're going to be perfect from here on out, that they don't have any mental issues. That's why this one will be swept under the rug, yet another case here that'll be swept under the rug. You have some reporting that's gone on talking about this shooter. But again, most of it has just been that what I read to you from Fox News. One of the stories here, or one of the reports that we have that has come out, again, a lot of it being put out there by social media is that this the shooter. Yeah, they said he/they used pronouns with female avatars on Instagram, TikTok, and Snapchat. Killed a sixth grader, injured five, also planted an IED in the school. And again, that's not something that you hear a lot of the national news media talking about. But it does go back to asking the question, not only about this shooter and other LGBT shooters, but all of these school shooters. It goes back to mental illness. It's not the problem of the gun. In this case, apparently the shooter had a shotgun and had a small caliber handgun. Still did damage, still killed people, still killed one student and injured five others. The gun isn't the problem. The gun isn't the problem anywhere in the United States. There's a mental health problem in the United States. I'd be willing to bet this student also didn't have a strong male role model in their life. Like many of the shooters that we've seen involved in school shootings, they don't have strong male role models in their lives. This is probably also someone who liked to escape into alternative realities. Didn't have a lot of friends. I'm sure we'll see that. Didn't have a lot of friends, didn't talk to a lot of people. That's not normal. It's not normal for 17-year-olds not to have a lot of friends. And I know what you think. There are some 17-year-olds that are awkward, some 17-year-olds that just don't have that many friends. That's true. That does happen. But even some of the awkward 17-year-olds, well, they got awkward friends. It's not normal for people to retreat into different realities most of the day. You want to play video games, you want to do that, you recognize it's just a game, that's different. When you're coming up with avatars where you're a different person and you're living your online life as a different person and you don't have any friends and you don't have a real life, you're not involved in anything. That's not normal. And I'm sure we'll see some of that come out. Maybe. About this student. Maybe we'll see some other news come out about this before it's all swept under the rug. And we're told that, as one texter said, we'll be told that he or they or whatever, they're the victim. I'm sure there will be some who try to label them that. That he's the actual victim, the victim of society, the victim of the evil Republican Party. Surprised they haven't blamed Trump yet for it. 806-680-2790. You can text in. You can give us a call at 1-800-687-0790. When we come back, your phone calls, your text. We got much more to get to here on the Chad Hastie Show.
The Chad Hastie Show can be heard all over West Texas, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Tune in on News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO in Lubbock, News Talk 940 in Amarillo, News Talk 94.7 and 1470 KYYW in Abilene, and in Wichita Falls on News Talk 96.3 and 1290. The Chad Hastie Show. Make it a part of your drive home, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
I'm Ryan Seacrest. First responders are people who stand for a greater purpose. They will be there for you when nobody else is, to help you, your family, your community. This is their selfless promise. This is their sworn duty, to protect, to serve, to help. When you call 911, first responders show up now. Let's show up for the people who show up for us every day and every night.
Go to firstrcf.org and make a difference today.
Midwest's most connected media outlet for election 2024. News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO and KFYO.com.
Chad Hasty Show. Say a chilly day, chilly evening out there. Going to get colder, of course. That's why, again, today's one of those good days to curl up with a good book. And we've been asking you the books people need to read going into this new year. What are the books that people need to read? You can text in your book recommendations on the text line, 806-680-2790. One texter say 1984 and A Brave New World people need to read for 2024. Another, let's see, Mark in Abilene saying the writer of The White House, the U.S. President in Prophecy. Let's see if people can get that at Amazon. Another texter, Where Did He Get the Guns? I'm sure that will come out at some point, maybe. Another texture, Mark in California, weighing in. The shooter didn't use the dreaded AR, so no one cares. You're absolutely right about the mental health issue. And you are right, by the way, since the AR-15 or an AR-15-like device, they always use that in the media, since one of those wasn't used, it's another reason why this story will go away quickly. Let's see. You can weigh in on the text line, 806-680-2790. Elizabeth weighing in. Just joined the conversation. Isn't it interesting, coincidental, that the shooting happened in the smallest town in Iowa? What's going on politically in Iowa right now? Inquiring minds want to know. And that was one of the first things I thought. Oh, of course, here we go. In Iowa, 11 days out from the Iowa caucus. Now we're going to turn the attention to guns. But because it was a trans or LGBTQ WTF shooter, this is going to go away. Because the administration doesn't want to have this type of discussion. They don't want to talk about this. They don't want to, if there was any kind of writings involved, they definitely don't want to talk about it. The TikTok of the shooter has already been scrubbed. There were images from the alleged shooter's TikTok account. Had the rainbow flag on there. Now, of course, this doesn't mean that everyone who's LGBTQ lifestyle is going to be a school shooter. No. It goes back to one of the big mental health discussions that we've talked about, and about how some of these, about how the trans students, the trans gendered students, those whose parents are telling them at the age of 8, 9, 10, 11 years old that they're not the gender they were born as. They have health issues. They have mental issues that they need professional help. And going in and having things cut off or, being prescribed to prescription pills in order to, castrate yourself is not the fix that the administration and that Democrats would have you believe. The left in this country, they believe that just let anybody be what they want to be and call anybody what they say they are. Just believe them and everything will be okay. And we see that that's not true, that so many of these trans students and just trans individuals, they have issues with depression. They're depressed. They have very high rates of suicide. And a little pill or a surgical treatment is not going to solve it. 806-680-2790. Let's see. You can send in your thoughts on the text line. Let's see. We've had two votes now for Chronicles of Brothers. Three that came in, actually. How about this? Trump and DeSantis, speaking of Iowa, zone in on Haley, just 11 days left in Iowa. Trump and Ron DeSantis playing tag team Thursday to attack Nikki Haley for her stance on the border and her attitude to Iowa, cementing her status as the candidate most likely to cause an upset in the nomination race. The former president, Florida, and the Florida governor have both stepped up their criticism of Haley as she surges in the polls. It intensified further with just 11 days to go before Iowa holds its caucuses to select the state's preferred candidate. The Trump campaign Wednesday launching its first TV attack on Haley in the state of New Hampshire, which she's targeting for a win. Now, there was a poll that was released earlier today out of New Hampshire. Let me see if I can bring that up real quick. And that is one of these states where Nikki Haley is doing very well. Let's see, the latest New Hampshire Republican primary poll shows Trump ahead of Nikki Haley at 37%, Nikki Haley at 33% in New Hampshire. Chris Christie is at 10%, Ron DeSantis at 5%. If Ron DeSantis doesn't win in Iowa, and he's not going to win anywhere else. He's not going to win in New Hampshire. He's not going to win in Florida. He's not going to win anywhere. It'll be time for him to go and drop out if he doesn't win in Iowa, and he's not going to. Now, there's been a shift since December 20th in which Trump has ticked up 4 percentage points. Nikki Haley has ticked up 4 percentage points. Chris Christie has fallen by 3 percentage points. And Ron DeSantis has dropped by 1%. So has Vivek Ramaswamy. So, again, that according to the American Research Group out of New Hampshire. That's the best Haley is doing anywhere, is within 4 percentage points of Donald Trump in New Hampshire. Now, when you look outside of New Hampshire, in Iowa, Trump blows them all out of the water. I mean, when you look at any other state, Trump is doing just huge. So all Nikki Haley really has here is a possibility, maybe, upset win in Iowa. That's what she's hoping for. And maybe an upset win in New Hampshire. She's hoping that'll turn the tide, that'll get everyone voting for Nikki Haley. I don't see it happening. Another texture, are we still waiting to see the Tennessee LGBT? Yeah. Still waiting for all that info. You won't see it, by the way, except for the leaks that have been out there, but you won't see anything official. When we come back, your phone calls, your text messages, and more.
The Chad Hastie Show, weekdays 5 to 7 p.m. Sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. Today's markets from the Texas Department of Ag.
Howdy, neighbors. Texas feeder cattle auction reporting prices steady. Cattle futures were down. February live cattle futures down 72 cents, closed at 171.12. January feeder cattle futures down $1.40, closed at 224.68. March cotton futures down a point, closed at 80.12. March wheat futures up 4 cents, closed at 625 a bushel. March corn up a penny to close at 466. January soybean futures down 8 cents, closed at $12.62 a bushel. January soybean meal futures up 20 cents, closed at $381.20 per ton. January Class A milk futures down a nickel, closed at $15.26 a hundred. February crude oil futures down 51 cents, closed at $72.19 per barrel. And the Dow Jones is up 10 points, closed at 37,440. And that's Market Roundup from the Texas Department of Agriculture. I'm your commissioner, Sid Miller. And remember, friends, Texas agriculture matters. Sold.
The news and talk of West Texas. News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO. Chad Hastie, talking the news. at the start, middle, and end of your drive home and when news breaks. This is the Chad Hastie Show.
All right, welcome back to the Chad Hastie Show. Appreciate you being out there today. You can send in your thoughts on the text line, 806-680-2790. It's 806-680-2790. Trump hitting Nikki Haley on the border issues, tying her to Biden on the border. This from justthenews.com. The former president releasing a campaign ad on Thursday attacking Nikki Haley, tying her to Biden's border policies. Quote, record numbers streaming across her borders, costing taxpayers billions and almost as many Americans killed from fentanyl as killed in World War II. The ad, titled Enough is Enough, opens. Yet Haley and Biden oppose Trump's border wall. The attack ad comes with the first presidential nominating race in Iowa, scheduled for January 15th. Record number of illegal immigrants have been entering the U.S. under Biden. By the way, there's a new caravan heading this way. And it's supposed to be one of the largest caravans ever seen. Quote, confirmed warnings of terrorists sneaking through our southern border. Yet Haley joined Biden in opposing Trump's visitor ban from terrorist nations. Haley's weakness put us in grave danger. Trump's strength protects us. Trump's 32nd ad concludes. Haley, who served as ambassador under Trump, still polling more than 30 points behind Trump in Iowa, according to an analysis from 538, also behind Trump's closest rival, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, by more than 2 points in Iowa. Again, the only hope that Nikki Haley has is to pull off a huge upset win in Iowa, which, again, I don't see that happening, and somehow pulling out a win in New Hampshire, which is possible, but even Trump's polling higher in New Hampshire. It's tighter than it is in Iowa and in other parts of the country, but it's still Trump who's ahead. And I think most of the votes from candidates who leave the race, including people like Ron DeSantis and Vivek Ramaswamy, if they drop out after Iowa, I think most of those votes are going to go towards Donald Trump. I don't see them all going towards Nikki Haley. Now, Nikki Haley has gone back and forth on her support of the wall. There are times where she's been on video where she has said that she supports the wall, the times where she said that it doesn't work. And that's what you get from a lot of Republicans, by the way. You know, a lot of the traditional Republicans that you have, even, and again, I know we had some texters yesterday who were talking about Tim Scott. It's something I've said time and a question that I've asked about Tim Scott time and time and time again. He seems like a very nice guy. Tim Scott seems like he would be a great ambassador for the United States. He sounds like someone that you would love to speak to the soul of the nation when it comes to family, when it comes to when it comes to getting back to the basics of the American family. Tim Scott sounds great. But does Tim Scott say anything different than any other Republican that we've seen since, I'll just go back to the year 2000, when you had compassionate conservatism being talked about from George W. Bush? Does Tim Scott, does Nikki Haley sound any different than George W. Bush? Do they sound any different than Mitt Romney? I don't mean Mitt Romney today. I mean Mitt Romney 4 years ago. Mitt Romney 8 years ago. Do they sound any different than Mitt? Do they sound any different than some of the other big-time Republicans that we've seen before? Do they sound any different than a Marco Rubio? Do they sound any different than Paul Ryan? Again, a lot of these Republicans, they have got some great ideas. They do. They've also got some bad ideas. And then there's the question of, do they have the fight? There's a reason why Trump is still doing so well. He's seen as the outsider. He's not the most conservative politician we know. We get that. We understand that. By now, everyone should know that Trump is not the most conservative politician we've ever seen. He simply isn't. But at this point, that's not what the voters care about. And even some of the most conservative voices that we have heard before, or more conservative than Trump before, really haven't done anything to stop the spending in America. They haven't really done anything to address the national debt that we have in America. So what people want right now is someone who's going to win. Someone who's going to stop the Democrat wokeness. Someone who is going to stop the out-of-control insanity that we see from the Democrats. Someone who will maybe win the cultural war. May not get to the fiscal war right now. May not get to the fiscal battles that lay ahead of us. But maybe we'll get to some of the societal issues that lay before us. Texter weighing in. No debate from Trump. I think he's hiding. I think they're hiding Trump like Biden. Trump might be missing some marbles. Well, here's what I'll say about that. I don't think that they're hiding Trump. Well, they are, but politically, there is no reason why Trump needs to debate anybody in the Republican primary. And I'm speaking politically. Politically, if I were making money off the Trump campaign, and they were asking me, what should we do? I would tell them not to get involved in a debate. You're winning. You're far and ahead of any other Republican nationally. There's no reason politically why you should debate. Now, for those who want to see a debate, and again, I'm one of those who I would be just fine, and I think Trump should debate. Just so we can get that battle of ideas. But I understand it's not going to happen. It doesn't make me mad. It doesn't make me upset. Doesn't make me disappointed in Trump. I'm just one of those geeks who like to see a good debate. I'm a political nerd. Guilty. I'm not someone who just wants to hand off the nomination to somebody. I think you got to work for it a little bit more. But I'm not going to not vote for Trump because of that. And that's not going to drive my primary vote when I go to the polls on Super Tuesday. Did Trump debate? I'm not going to care about that on Super Tuesday. That's not going to be in my top issues for who I'm going to vote for. I think Trump's going to be the nominee. I think he'll probably have it wrapped up by Super Tuesday, maybe. Maybe you'll have to, you know, really keep campaigning, maybe, on Super Tuesday. But I think it'll pretty much be wrapped up after New Hampshire. And do I think he's losing it a little bit? No. I don't think he's losing it. I don't think he's losing his marbles. I think he has it a lot more together than we see Joe Biden. I think at this point, Trump feels a little bit free to say even more so whatever he feels like. And you're probably going to get a lot more of that because if he does win the election, which I think he will, he's going to be someone who can say whatever he wants because he can't win again. So he's going to be really free to say anything that he wants to because he really won't worry about offending anybody. And the Democrats are scared to death of that, by the way. And so are some Republicans. They're scared of that, too. 806-680-2790. Give us a call. 1-800-687-0790. When we come back, your phone calls, your text messages, and we'll begin to wrap up another edition of the Chad Hastie Show. Thank you.
We live Texas. We breathe Texas. The landmarks, the swagger, and the lore make us who we are. We devour the tastes and the smells of our state. You just might say there's something in the air. So do your part to help protect it. Keep your tires at the correct pressure and avoid idling at drive-thrus. Both help reduce emissions. For tips, visit drivecleantexas.org. Drive clean, Texas. Live and breathe it. Brought to you by TxDOT.
I answered the call. Together, we fought for our nation and its people. And even though I no longer wear the uniform, I am still a Marine. My service has come full circle. I will continue to support my country and my community. Then and now, Semper Fidelis remains my promise. Always faithful, always Marine.
Welcome back to the Chad Hasty Show. Final segment. How about this story? Out of KXAN. You could be carrying around a Powerball ticket worth $1 million. Nick, it could be you. A ticket worth $1 million. That was purchased for the July 19th, 2023 drawing remains unclaimed. And the deadline to claim it is on Monday, January 15th. Otherwise, that $1 million ticket is gone. Boy, how would you like to be that person who bought the ticket? And you know you bought a lottery ticket in Houston. At the Big Shot. Which, by the way, if you're going to win $1 million, it needs to be at a place called the Big Shot. The Big Shot at 9780 Bissonnette Street in Houston. Two ways to claim the winning lottery ticket if it's yours: in person at any Texas Lottery Claim Center and by mail. How'd you like to be the person who you know you bought a lottery ticket on that day? You know you went to the Big Shot. You know that there's a chance that you won $1 million. And you can't find the ticket. You're looking everywhere. You've gone through your jeans pockets 20 times looking for that $1 million ticket. Nick, how frustrated would you be if you knew you had a ticket somewhere and you couldn't find it? How many times are you turning your house upside down? Going through any place that you ever put, you know that drawer that you have inside your house? Usually it's right around the kitchen somewhere. It's the everything else drawer. You open it up and there's some scissors in there. There's a couple of pens, some thread. You don't know why there's thread in there, but there's some thread in there. Maybe a couple of buttons. Some medicine. Who knows? How many times has that drawer been opened? People going through seeing if they've got that ticket. Texter says, Houston, maybe they died. That's always possible. That it is a violent city. Houston is very violent. It's a morbid thing to think about, but it is possible that they died. You know, there's some people in Houston right now going, okay, you know, the family member died, and they knew that they played the lottery. They're going through the closet looking for different little scraps of paper. See if they can find a lotto ticket somewhere. Oh, what a terrible feeling that must be. Just to know, if you bought the ticket, and you know the deadline's coming up, and you just know, oh, I bought that ticket. You had it somewhere in your wallet. Worse yet, you put it in the wash. You had put it in your pants pocket. Somebody decided, we're going to do laundry today. Didn't check the pants pocket. Boom. It's got to be a bad feeling. Got to be a bad feeling. That would be one that's that would eat you up if you had the winning ticket for $1 million and you couldn't find it. Oh, be terrible. 806-680-2790. I guess you could always tell that person, hey, $1 million isn't as much as it used to be. It's okay. There's worse things in life than losing a $1 million ticket. Now, the best part would be finding that $1 million ticket just laying on the ground somewhere. See, that's the flip side. If you're someone just walking around and you come upon a ticket and you're like, hey, I got $1 million here. Nick, what is the largest amount of money that you have just found?
$20.
A $20 bill?
I found a multiple times I found a $20 bill. The most recent, I was dog sitting.
Yeah.
For a friend in a different neighborhood. And, just took the dog out. And, I see a little, your heart skips a beat.
Yes.
You see that little green fabric
it's
sticking out of the grass? Yeah. And I picked it up. And, I say every time. The two times that I found a $20 bill, I look around.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, I don't want to just take it.
Sure.
I see someone like fumbling with their wallet nearby. I mean, whatever. So I look around. I'm like, it's just me. I know the dog didn't drop it. So I free $20.
Free $20.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The most I have found was a $50 bill. It was a $50 bill. I found it at the old Texas Stadium, which probably bought somebody like two beers. But the old Texas Stadium, not AT&T Stadium, the old Texas Stadium. I was young. I was looking at the ground, and I went, and I found a $50 bill. Now, I found a $20 bill a couple of times. And then, a few $10 bills, I found that. Haven't found the $1 million one just yet. Texture, it's a bad day when you find the $1 million ticket the day after it expires. Ooh, that would hurt. Yeah, that would hurt. Enjoy the rest of your evening. Follow me on social media at Chad HD Radio. Stay safe, stay healthy, stay warm. Drive safe. God bless you all. We'll see you tomorrow.
The Chad Hasty Show, a presentation of the Texas Town Square Media Network. The views and opinions expressed during the Chad Hasty Show are not necessarily the views of this station's staff, management, advertisers, or Town Square Media.